So the major illnesses I will be talking about and answering questions about after this introduction are some forms of cancer that to some degree are preventable, because that's the key tonight, prevention. You see, as a doctor, you can get some satisfaction out of making a diagnosis, say of a difficult case, but it's much more satisfying to preventing illness in the first place. And that's what's the central task of family medicine, okay? So how can we try to prevent some forms of cancer, cardiovascular diseases, meaning heart attack, stroke, diabetes, what can we do to avoid diabetes? Dementia, that dreaded Alzheimer's disease and variations of it. And then, because we're family medicine, and I said the name of this, and we've said the name of the series is Family Medicine to the Rescue. Throughout the life cycle, we deliver babies, we take care of children, we take care of teenagers, young adults, so that I will say, talk about some of the major illnesses, and we have this word in medicine, morbidities, things that happen, like illnesses, and even mortalities that happen at an adolescent level and pediatric level at times. Okay, cancer. Well, Leonard Cohen has a song, Everybody Knows, you know, everybody knows the dice is loaded, and everybody knows that if you smoke, you have a significant chance, 12 times more than anybody who doesn't smoke, to get lung cancer. And lung cancer is very bad news. You can be struck by a very significant illness and die in a very short time, relatively. Now, if you don't smoke, you're much less likely to get lung cancer. You can get it inhaling smoke if you're constantly in a situation where you're inhaling someone else's smoke. It's happened to people who have no relation that we can trace to smokers, but I think we here at the Jewish have our cancer prevention center, and we have a smoking cessation program that's free, that's supported by a group sort of format, and it's kind of spoken for itself, okay? Colon cancer. Major cancers that strike in life are colon cancer, breast cancer, cervical cancer, and we'll talk about them, but colon cancer. Now, colon cancer, you can have a good chance of preventing it, very good, by having a colonoscopy. Everybody over 50 and over, it's recommended by different task forces. You know, different countries, like Canada has a health prevention task force, the United States, and you get different opinions, and also from different medical specialty groups, about, for instance, colonoscopy, how often you should do it, whether you should do it, okay? Well, comes down to the recommendation is everybody 50 and over, it'd be a good idea to have it every 7 years. Some people say 5, some people say 10, but 7's in the middle. But when you talk about anything with your doctor, you see, and we in family medicine, what we teach the 48 young doctors in our residency program who spend 2 years with us, is that your patient is a partner with you in their own healthcare, okay? Patients are experts at being patients. And one of my mottos is the patient's always right sometimes. So we like to really share decisions with our patients and make them partners in decisions we make. So what I'm trying to say about colonoscopy, what I'll say to a patient is, yes, colonoscopy, what happens is if you do it every 7 years, you might get, as well as finding cancer that's already developed, one might find polyps that are benign, they're not malignant, but a small percentage of polyps can become cancerous, so they can be removed. A downside of colonoscopy is about 2 or 3 per 10,000 people who have a colonoscopy can get a perforation, like that the scope can actually provoke a bowel perforation and a hemorrhage. Well, not very good, okay? So someone might say, well, it's not worth it to me to take that chance, even if it's 1 in 10,000, 2 in 10,000, 3. So that person, it's very reasonable if they decide, no, I don't want to go near it. If you do a stool for occult blood, for blood that may be in the stool, if you do a test once a year, it's also a pretty good way of preventing colon cancer. In other words, if you find some blood in the stool, then you have a colonoscopy. But if you don't, you're doing something quite significant. And these are the kind of decisions all the way along that we like to make with our patients, not just dictate to them, here's what you should do. Other cancers that are quite preventable. We've had a good success story with cervical cancer. Cancer at where the cervix, you know, there's a vagina, the cervix, and then the uterus. And Pap screening for women has really diminished the amount of cervical cancer. And we've also made some progress. The HPV, the human papilloma virus, is now discovered to be basically a very important causal factor in cervical cancer, that women who have sexual intercourse, okay, run the risk of having contact with human papilloma virus. That virus can precipitate the development of cervical cancer in their life. Now, if you don't have HPV virus present, by and large, you won't get cancer. So we've simplified the process now. What we do here in the Jewish and in the Department of Family Medicine is women under 30, like 20 to 30, we don't do them on people under 20 because they've largely had no time to develop a cervical cancer. Under 30, we'll do a Pap screen. After 30, we'll just simply put in a swab to see if papillomavirus is present. If it's not present, you don't need a Pap smear. Now, that's a revolution. But there's an even bigger revolution is human papillomavirus vaccine, which kids in Quebec are getting in school now at 10 years old or and on, okay, approximately 10. And that will eliminate the possibility of them getting papillomavirus. So we're on the road to eliminating that cancer. Someday it might be like smallpox. So we do make some progress. Breast cancer. What the common recommendation now that comes from government programs and government sort of public health estimations is that every female 50 and over should have a mammograph every 2 years. And it can certainly detect cancer in an earlier form and then certainly influence treatment and mortality. And prostate cancer is a more complicated story, okay, because there's controversy about it. controversy isn't new to medicine, okay? That Descartes, 17th century, said, medicine is a science forced into practice too early. He must have had a bad day at his doctor, okay? Because it's still the same, that it's not exactly always a science. You have certain facts, and not all the facts are available yet. Some of the facts we have are so partial that they ultimately turn out to be destructive or harmful or wrong. So at any rate, here's what's happened. Most men in the audience know that PSA screening has been going on for years. It's a hormone elaborated by the prostate, and if the level is more than 4, it's like 0 to 4 is normal, then there's some risk that one might be developing prostatic cancer. And for many years, men have had ultrasound rectal biopsies based on the fact that their PSA was above 4. It's gotten so many men into operations that they didn't really need because they had a cancer that was so slow growing that they would have died at something else in their lifetime before it ever gave them trouble, but they ended up having, perhaps some of them, urinary incontinence or erectile difficulties as a result of the operation. And so now people are saying only case fine, someone who's having symptoms of prostatic disease or someone whose father had it at an early age, et cetera, or father had it. But I disagree, you see. I could spend the rest of the night telling certain anecdotes of people who it's lucky they had a PSA or unlucky they didn't. So I still screen for it, but the new thing that I can share with you tonight is the real issue is not whether you screen for it, it's what do you do with it. That it looks, looking backward, it looks like we were pushing people into, you know, with good intentions, like I said, into surgery at a threshold that was too low. Looking backwards, they probably shouldn't have had the surgery. But what's developed, and what's developed, the Jewish is becoming a center for it, is following the size of the prostate with MRIs instead of biopsies at these lower levels. And we're becoming one of the major centers in North America for that. It'll be a heavy toll on our X-ray facilities, and questions will arise about how many MRIs could we do, but this is the way medicine advances. And this is the way you really have the responsibility of sharing this kind of information with your patient. So when you say to a male patient, okay, you're 50, because let's talk about prevention. You should have a colonoscopy, PSA, I'll explain to you what the issues are and you can make a choice. So that's, again, the theme here for tonight is self-help guide to preventing major illness. So your physician, these are preventive diagnostic tests that your family doctor can help you make a decision about when you want to do them, the frequency. But, so I've just told you about medical diagnostic tests that you can do, but here's things you can do yourself. You can talk to your doctor about it and give you advice, but here's something that's in your control. I said the stock market's not in your control, and a lot of other factors, but this is. It's your weight, okay? Talking about cancer, there's certain cancers that are somewhat more frequent in overweight people. I mean, you don't have to be overweight to get breast cancer, but there's a higher percentage of people who are overweight who will get it, women. uterus, likewise pancreas. So there's something that could be controlled, and we'll talk more about weight and how you control it. But there's more than increased cancer for overweight. Now, vitamin D. They're looking around the audience. I'm sure there was many people who were around with the vitamin E craze. You know, Linus Pauling, vitamin C, vitamin E. And vitamin E became the miracle that if you take vitamin E, nothing bad will ever happen to you. Well, you know, like anything that's around for very long, you know, I've been a doctor for 40 years. So I've watched things change every 5 years, you know. Like infants with croup, you know, that horrible cough. I've seen hot steam, cold steam, no steam. Okay. When I was a medical student for diverticulosis, they said low-fiber diet. Now they say high-fiber diet. You could sort of lose faith. But vitamin D, it's being touted right now as a kind of very, very major cancer prevention. Take 1,000 units of vitamin D, and it'll protect you against a lot of things. Well, then recently, a large series, it was slightly increased mortality, okay? So, but was it because of confounding variables? What's a confounding variable? It's something in a study that it turns out was a factor that turned it around that it's not the real issue, okay? So, I'm very cautious myself. I just about don't take anything. I'm saying don't walk out of here saying you're never going to take anything, but take anything with a grain of salt, okay? But here, weight. Again, beyond cancer, a study that was done a few years ago in the United States and reported in the Journal of Cardiology was one where they traced the following. They took 100,000 men who had had heart attacks, and they charted their age of onset of the heart attack against their weight. The ones who were overweight had their heart attack 9 years before the other people, and it went up in early onset relative to their weight. And the ones who were obese, like very overweight, had it 12 years. That's 12 years of life, deprived of their life with their family, because they were overweight. Now, diabetes. Right now, anybody born in Canada in the year 2000 has 1/3 chance in their lifetime of getting diabetes. Now, that is something really, really screwy, eh? I mean, you can remember when many years ago, not just because it wasn't detected, diabetes wasn't, like, around to the degree it is now. And here's the story. 1/3 of Canadians will be diabetic at present by the time they're 57 years old. Once you become diabetic, you have 12 times the chance of having a heart attack, stroke, dialysis, you know, the approximate figures. But diabetes doesn't really happen, by and large, unless you get overweight, not always, but here's the way it is. There's an inherited genetic predisposition. And people who have that genetic predisposition will probably get diabetes if they get overweight. Now, some little babies are born with diabetes and children have diabetes. That's something different. That's something genetic, something maybe after a viral infection. It's rarer, but that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about generalized diabetes, adult onset coming on in later adult life. So if those people did not get overweight, by and large, they wouldn't have got it. Now, look, what does that mean? We're talking about prevention. So if family doctors were to be very conscious of their responsibility in reminding their patients all along the line that it's not a good idea to get overweight, we would eliminate a huge toll of disease, complications, and we're family doctors. So what we're witnessing is something wrong with the lifestyle. There's not enough exercise on the whole, and overeating with foods that are not really conducive to a good weight, okay, things you all know about. So here's the bottom line. We're, in the last 30 years, we're starting to see an epidemic of childhood overweight and obesity and adolescent overweight and obesity. Now, we're starting to see diabetes among teenagers. These kids are going to grow up, and by 30 years old, they'll be having heart attacks. So, you know, we're talking about things you can control, or not just you sitting there, but patients can control. Now, I just told you 50% of Canadians now are overweight, and this is new. Okay, I mean, relatively new, because we're getting more sedentary and more destructive in the way we eat. 33% of Canadians are obese, like super overweight. And there's an epidemic of overweight and obesity in children and adolescents, with all the consequences that I just spoke of. Well, one can control it. You can control it in how you eat. I mean, I'm not going to turn the rest of this lecture into how to control your weight, because that your family doctor can help you, a nutritionist can help you, who he might send you to. But avoid fats and sugar, okay? Fats, you know, you've read about it. The poly and unsaturated are good in certain kind of oils, whether olive oil, peanut oil, versus saturated fats that you find in fat of meat and trans fats. Sugar, at the turn of the century, people were having about 4 pounds of sugar in a year. Now they have 40. And kids, there's 5-2-1-0, what's that? To counter this epidemic of childhood and teenage obesity, there's a program that's sweeping through a lot of schools in the United States, 5-2-1-0. The five is 5 fruits and vegetables a day, that instead of having snacks of chips and other kind of junk food, if you can convince kids to have fruit, vegetables. It's hard to get a kid to nibble on a vegetable in the middle of the day, but at least a fruit. Now, all this applies to adults as well. The two is about the increased amount of sedentary time our kids are spending at computers, sitting around with their iPhones or iPads. So avoid anything more than 2 hours a day beyond homework of sedentary activity. The one is ideally 1 hour a day of exercise. That's getting more rare in our schools with declining budgets, declining amount of time after school activities. Zero is zero sugary drinks, like certainly Coke, soda. And then a lot of so-called fruit drinks are really just largely sugar. And these are tremendous kind of input of calories. But there's a caution here. We can go overboard on weight control, and we can create kids and teenagers who really get pushed along the road to anorexia if you make them too crazy about weight and make a cult about weight and fat, and you can actually get into the nightmare of anorexia. So you gotta have a real balance here. You should really be talking to kids and teenagers more about, rather than their weight, it's more about a healthy lifestyle with exercise and good food, and watch it. Because anorexia, in addition to the kind of stimulus we get from the fashion world and the super thin, it's a very malignant form of mental illness. It's got the highest suicide rate, the highest death rate of psychiatric conditions. And what I would say about it is, in addition, I'm saying in a person who probably has a genetic disposition, you know, to be, could head that way, it is probably largely neurochemical, like neuroendocrine. See, a whole generation of parents were unjustly really treated badly. And these were the ones who had the first, well, what we began to know as and label as autistic children. There was a theory, and they were told, it's because you're cold intellectuals, like with you're kind of emotionally crippled and you haven't given your kids enough warmth. It's absolutely untrue. We've come to find it's really organic with genetic sites. And this was adding insult to injury. I think it's the same with anorexia. I think there's a real organic neuroendocrinological basis. And then there's a lot of theories. Well, this girl's getting anorectic because the parents are in conflict and she wants to divert attention and bring the parents together. Well, it's not really fair. I mean, 40% of families divorce. 20% are thinking about it. 20% probably should. So what does that leave? You know, so if you want to make psychological theories about family conflict being the cause of anorexia, you certainly got a ripe field, okay? So, you know, there's psychological factors involved, but unfortunately, there are some very satanic neuroendocrine ones, but you know, you do what you can. But so there's this balance. I mean, I don't want people to walk out of here and go back to their children and their grandchildren and create anorectics. We have to balance, okay? Yeah, overweight is not a good thing, but neither is anorexia. Now, dementia. Very, very, very terrifying illness. Sad. But it turns out that exercise, this is something you can control, which is certainly helpful for weight control. It turns out, surprisingly, there is a report of the Brain Institute recently that's in Ontario that they're according to a meta-analysis. Well, what's a meta-analysis? You do a study, it's one study. If you want to find out what thousands of studies have said, you go online and you get them all together and you say, well, looks like when you get them all together that there's a 40% reduction of risk of Alzheimer's for people who really exercise on a regular basis, and even a half hour a day of walking is considered exercise, okay? Remember the grain of salt? Okay. That's what they're saying now, 5 years, they may say, you know, there was a confounding variable that all those people who we thought were just saving themselves by exercising were doing something else as well. But I think there's a certain amount of truth in it. Then what I'd say, it's Alzheimer's, just like I talked about anorexia. And this is the thing about being a family doctor. You see, you live with all the diseases. You're not a specialist who can cure ultimately some of these diseases. You can diagnose them, help control them, at times cure them. But what I'm getting at is we live with the continual spectrum. So I'm showing you the kind of similarities here. Autism, anorexia, there's an organic cause, and there's no doubt Alzheimer's, there's an organic cause. There's a chemical, biochemical. Some people have a predisposition based on certain kind of things that go on chemically in the brain, the deposition of certain proteins, etc. However, you start off with a predisposition, but there's environmental things that influence it. Maybe you would have escaped the predisposition had you controlled certain things in your environment. Now, as Glenn was telling you, I worked for many years in native health. And I was struck by the fact that up in northern Quebec, among the Inuit and the Cree, I would go up there and I would do clinics, and I would see, for instance, on the geriatric afternoon, I would see some people in their 80s. Actually, length of life up there is less than down here from infection, alcohol, accidents. But the people who do really survive, often they're the ones who are still living the traditional way of life. So they're out in the bush and they're active and they're hunting and they're still kind of got a kind of control that some of the younger people don't. So, interesting, there's one time a year when there's up among the Cree, there's the goose break, where the goose are above and people want to go hunting. And they go out in the bush, you know, by helicopter, by plane, further from the settlement. Now, if you're over 75, you have to go to the doctor and get a permit, in a sense, like it's like a driving license that you can go out in the bush, because if you go out in the bush and you have a heart attack or a stroke, or and it's going to cost $10,000 to send an airplane and a helicopter to get you. So the doctor after says, okay, he can go. Now, I was doing one of those clinics and it struck me, all these people, they were very there. I wasn't seeing any dementia among these elders. And so I phoned other people who work in Indian health around North America, and they said, you know, you're right. Now, I never did a study because we'd have to make, you know, there's these questionnaires that you give to people who you're wondering if they're getting demented with questions like, what does this mean? Don't people who live in glass houses shouldn't throw stones and everything. So I would have had to make a whole Inuktitut or Inuit translation, you know. I'm just a family doctor, right? So, but it was an impression I had, and it was borne out when I phoned the other people who work in Native Health. And so here's what I think is going on. If your value, you have a life in your community that you're involved and you're valued by your family, like these older people are, they want them to live with them because they know how to hunt, they know how to make the clothes, they know the stories. But if on the other hand, like down here, if someone dies and then their wife or their husband said, geez, it's rough to have so-and-so live with us, why don't we put them in a foster home? And so if you sit in a foster home in sweatpants and watch TV and get disconnected, you're much more likely to fall prey to, I think, you know, a dementing process. So that's why I say the goose break versus foster homes. It has to do with keeping our elder people valued and involved. Now, preventing teenage disease and mortality, okay? If you look, one of the reasons I became involved with teenagers, because as a doctor, I like to be practicing medicine where you're needed. That's what brought me up to all those years, up to Northwest Territories, Hudson Bay, because our native population, it's like a third world. They have more kind of pressing medical and unmet medical needs, say, than down here, although we certainly have a lot to meet down here, okay? But teenagers. Teenagers are the only group in our society whose mortality, the death rate, has not improved in the last 30 years. Everybody else, the average older person lives, females to 82, males to 78. Babies, we can save them at 26 weeks now, and the newborn, you know, in the NICU. Teenagers are dying at the same old rate or more increased in the last 30 years. Why? Because their causes of death are really social to some degree. The first is car accidents. If I asked you, what's the average age of death in a car in North America and Canada? What's the average age of a person dying in a car in both Canada and the United States right now? Anybody take a guess? 18. It's a massacre, okay? Teenagers are only 12% of the population, but they're 40% of the accidents. And 80% of those accidents involve marijuana and alcohol. And in that order, marijuana more. People don't realize you can't smoke marijuana and drive. And in New York State, you can't drive till you're 18 and you can't drink till you're 21. It's enforced. And they don't have these massacre rates. In Quebec, you can drive when you're 16 and the drinking, it's not really, really enforced, so you can see what you get. The second is suicide. The suicide rate for teenagers has increased by 500% in those 30 years. That's enormous, okay? It used to be 8 per 100,000 for males, now it's 20. What's going on? Well, I could spend the rest of the night talking about family breakdown, drugs, the promotion of drugs since the 60s, but it's there, and that's why we have an outreach program that we go in schools and talk to kids in their classes and give them a 24-hour number. The other is the sixth most common medical cause of death for teenagers in both Canada and the United States is AIDS. That might surprise you. You think of, well, AIDS, it's homosexuals, drug addicts, but wait, these are teenagers. What's it all about? Teenagers are the second most sexually active group in the population. They're second by a little bit to the 20 to 24-year-olds. But they're the worst actors. They have more sexually transmitted disease per active person. So there's sexually transmitted diseases out there, and where does the AIDS come from? It's street kids. Kids who've left home for whatever reason, sometimes justified. And they're living out on the street, and they're doing prostitution, and they're taking IV drugs, and they spread it to other teenagers. So it's a kind of third world, and that's why we have our teenage unit. But what can people do about it? Parents, not just doctors. Well, there's a sociologist, Joey Dreyfus, who wrote a book called Safe Passage, How to Get Your Teenager Safely Through Adolescence in a Risky Society, and the society I just described. And her answer is that teenager has to have at least one stable adult behind them, okay, with a 40% divorce rate. A kid needs at least one parent, if not two, who make them feel valued, that I may be funny looking and, you know, and this and that, but, I'm kind of worth something. Somebody loves me, and they think I'm worth something. And that will get you through a lot. But a lot of kids don't have that. And sometimes the doctor they're coming to becomes that person. And that's a bit what our program is sometimes about. See, it's about talking to your kids. A very recent WHO report, you might have saw it in the newspaper in the last few weeks, came out with something very stunning and upsetting, that they surveyed 39 countries, and Canada, and the question they were asking is to teenagers, how do you rate your communication with your parents about your ability to talk to your parents, getting advice for them, relating to them? And Canadian kids came out 34 out of 39. Man, okay? And it was at about 20% said it works. Most of these kids were between 11 and 16. Well, what's going on? It's mostly because their communication is with their cell phones, their iPads. It's all virtual. They're talking to their friends. They're talking to nobody. They're talking to some strangers online in a kind of website. And their parents have dropped out of the picture. Now, along with this kind of relative dehumanizing and lack of kind of guidelines, because kids need guidelines, you emerge with no real moral values and probably bullying and the kind of violent behavior that some of our teenagers are demonstrating comes from this breakdown. So what can we do to prevent major illness? This is major illness, okay? And it's about talking to your kids. Now, I described the sexual kind of scene where six most common causes of teenage death is AIDS right now. I think it's time to talk to contraception, about contraception to your kids. But, you know, in terms of teenage pregnancy, someone once said, the best contraceptive is a sound future. What does that mean? It means a girl who knows she wants to go into college and become this or that and go to graduate school and is thinking about where she's going to be, and she's been supported that she's worth something, and she's not likely to get pregnant because it would really get in the way. If a kid lives in inner city and has no future that she knows about, is dropping out of school, having children, it's not going to make a difference either way. She might even get welfare if she gets pregnant. So it's all about who we are as a society, how we're relating to our kids. And kids want guidelines, even if they're going to rebel against them. But the difference in creating guidelines for teenagers when you tell a child, 5-year-old, don't run on the road, it's not negotiable. But when you tell a teenager, well, I want you in by such and such a time, you could talk reasonably, let them be, you make the decision, but you could tell them what are the factors that are leading you to this decision, that they can understand, comment on them, might comment negatively, but at least they feel they're a partner. Just like I said, a family doctor makes his patient a partner. Now, coming to one more thing that is in your control, and it comes back to heart attacks, stroke, it's blood pressure. And you're going to say, wait a minute, how can I control my blood pressure? Well, it's interesting. When you go to a doctor and he takes your blood pressure, say you go to a walk-in clinic and you've never met him before and you're saying, well, I'm worried maybe that my blood pressure is, so first of all, maybe you waited 2 hours at the walk-in or three, and maybe you're worried about your parking. And okay, so he takes your blood pressure, and it's high. It's high because you're stressed at that moment. And then if it's not a good doctor or a good setup, he'll say, man, it's really high, I better give you some medicine. Then you'll come back in a month and you'll still be double parked and waiting 3 hours and say, you know, it's really even, it's higher. I think we should give you some more medicine, okay? So we have a machine in Herzl with actually a donor paid for us to have quite a few of them. It's called a BP True. If we just find that your blood pressure's high on the first taking, we sit you down and take it six more times over the next 12 minutes. We could take it six more times over the next 2.5 hours if we both wanted to do that, but it's interesting. Taking it six times in 12 minutes gives you the same result as a 24-hour monitor walking around with the 24 hours. And usually by the sixth time, somebody, people are kind of doing internal yoga and, you know, getting more relaxed. And, hey, they don't have high blood pressure, okay? But my point of this story, why I'm sharing you with that, is the original tension creates high blood pressure. So if somebody is walking around in life and they're angry and, you know, upset, given whatever predisposition genetically, they certainly might, it certainly influences your blood pressure. So I call a concept the Tao. You know, the Tao is one of the Eastern philosophies, Taoism. You have to find the middle way, the superior road, like good balance. Okay, so I'm saying how do you walk or how do you in life, try to be less upset, okay? Hey, man, that's a talk of another lecture, right? But in fact, the Naples rules, what normal tension means, hypertension is high blood pressure, hypotension is low, normal tension means the right blood pressure. And how can your psychological state and how you maintain your psychological state could certainly help maintaining a normal blood pressure, okay? Now, there's something I call the Naples rules. What are they? I'll explain. I had a patient who ended up in a drug rehabilitation program in Naples, Florida, and it was part of a national kind of program they have in the United States for rehabilitation, okay? And I actually was allowed to watch, with the permission of the people who were participating, a family session. When the person who has a drug problem goes into rehab, the family goes to family sessions with other families to support each other and learn how to help your relative who's going to emerge from rehab. But it's interesting because they were talking about beyond rehab from drugs. They said, let's talk about the basic rules about how people in a family should conduct themselves, whether they're a husband and wife, members of a family, and it came down to this. Avoid terms like, you always do this, you never do that, and you're in trouble when you start with you in the first place, okay? And yelling, calling names, you say, well, we never do that, but okay. Swearing. In an argument, bringing up the past. Yeah, you always do that. I mean, cause, you know, it's hopeless. You're always doing that, okay? Comparing them to somebody else. You don't listen to the other person, you walk away, sarcasm. Now, I'm not kind of preaching about this, I'm just talking about things we can all control, okay? Now, if we're gonna help each other in a family with stress, you gotta have this kind of approach, or this kind of approach can help. Now, access to care. In order to get a doctor who will help you on the things that are medical, I've told you the things you can control yourself. There's something that I find stressful after 40 years of being a doctor and 25 of being a teacher of family doctors. It's the access to family doctors, okay? And it's something distinctly Quebec. In Toronto, only 13% of people don't have a family doctor. In Calgary, just about everybody does, okay? What's going on? Well, there's something distinctly Quebec, okay? You are not allowed to work as a family doctor, young doctor in Montreal until you've gone for a designated period of time and worked up in the Région Éloignée, which is the farther northern areas where people are, you know, where it's harder to get doctors to work. How they get doctors to work in other provinces is simply to pay them significantly more. Here there's a punitive factor. You can't work in Montreal till you've supposedly gone up and done this. Now, the irony is there are more doctors per GPs per person in those areas, Lac Saint-Jean and all, than Montreal. Montreal, 40% of people don't have family doctors up there. There's no problem. Now, why? Because both parties, the Liberals and the PQs, for 30 years have done this really kind of heartless kind of policy, because 100 people in 100,000 miles up there have more voting power than 5 communities in Montreal. And so the young doctors say, well, I'm not going to drag my wife out of her job and my kids to another up there. I'm just going to go to Toronto. I'm going to go to Vancouver. So everything I'm saying about your doctor helping you, we do our best at Herzl, but it's like the little car at the circus. You know, we already have 25,000 patients. We take in a certain number per year, but it's like getting into graduate school. We're taking the sickest, pregnant women, teenagers, because of these problems that I was talking about. So, you know, those kind of frustrations, okay, like when, because I'm interested in teenagers, when I'm seeing teenagers often, I ask them a question because it helps you get to know them. What do you want to do when you finish school? It sounds sort of boring, you know, like an adult asking, but, and then sometimes they'll say, well, I don't really know. And I say, yeah, at 14, you don't have to know, but even on a fantasy, like, what would you want to do? But one kid, I asked him what he wanted to do, and he said he wanted to be a stuntman or a doctor. Now, I never felt there was a paradox, you see, because I've just shared with you tonight some of the things we live with. Some of the things are, we have a certain body of facts that keeps changing, and in the face of a lot of illness and that have socioeconomic and psychological factors, you feel like a stuntman sometime in getting helping to get people get through them. And then, in my old age, after being chief for 12 years, I decided to go and get a management degree in health management because I wanted to see if management is anything more than street fighting. Because what I just described as a stuntman, as an everyday doctor, I find in trying to figure out or to do something creative with the healthcare system, you come up against politics and everything I was talking about in the first slide that you can't control. Okay? Now, I'll just finish here. I haven't even looked at the time, Glenn, but yeah, hey, we're at 8:30, okay, so 8:33, so I'll be finished in a minute or two. I mentioned that I did go to management school to try and figure out some of these dilemmas of healthcare delivery, how to get health out to everybody. And interestingly, I came across a book called The Optimizing Edge. What's it all about? It's saying optimization is taking computer wisdom and human brain wisdom and wedding them together and getting the best solutions, okay? Computers can give us like logarithmic amounts of information in a second. Humans We have insights that a computer might not have. Could we get some insights on emotional, intuitive? We also have fears and egotism and a lot of other failings, okay? But how do you get the best out of both of them? So this particular management, he's the director of an information technology company in the States. And they are the consultants for UPS, parcel delivery. And after putting together the computer information and human sort of pondering, they presented, after a year of analysis, they presented UPS with a startling recommendation. No left turns, okay? Now, why? In the United States, you can turn right on a red light, right? They calculated that the amount of time spent idling, you burning fuel, wasting time, waiting to turn left, if you eliminated that, you would save millions and millions of dollars. Now, so now with UPS, you have to, the driver has to communicate with the dispatcher and convince him that, show him that, no, I really have to make a left turn or I'm not gonna get there, okay? And he gives another example that the McDonald's franchise is all over North America. We're pondering the same problem with computer data and thinking it over. It had to do with the breakfast special. There was a breakfast special up till 10:30 with, you know, whatever, I mean, eggs, I'll say it here, bacon, sausages, whatever, okay? And the question was how much to order and how much to make to prepare for up to 10:30 versus having to throw out a lot of stuff against sending away angry customers who say, forget this place, I'm going to Wendy's from now on, okay? So a franchise owner in Vancouver came up with a solution, and he called it the Mac 1031. It's a big Whopper with all the leftover stuff at a reduced price, okay? So there is a Mac 1031 for healthcare, okay? I'll just go back for a minute. I would say diet, don't get overweight, or correct it if you are. Exercise, and then living with mutual respect for one another within the Naples rules would give you a good start. So thanks a lot tonight for coming.
So here's the first one. Why is anorexia more common in girls than boys?
Wow, that's a really interesting question, because I said, it was probably neuroendocrinological at base. So then you might say, well, if it's neuroendocrinological, why is it 10 times more common in girls? Does it have to do with female hormones? Wow. Well, in fact, it's about 1 in 10. And most of the guys who are anorectic are ballet dancers, models. I would have to go back to the drawing board and say, I think, though, that's where this tremendous social craze about being super thin, it's more addressing to girls, you know, and kind of the models and all. And the Duchess of Windsor said, you can't be too thin or too rich, okay? So I think as I'm standing here and working it out, I think added there is fashion and that kind of intense media kind of glamorization of it super thin.
Okay, next, what cures cancers? Breast cancer, prostate cancer, what cures it?
Okay, that I would say that you have a lot of new hormonal therapy and chemotherapy and radiation techniques that are forever improved upon, and in fact, You can get cures if you get 5 years of remission, you're probably cured, okay? So that's the answer, combination of chemotherapy, hormone therapy, and radiation, and surgery.
You talked about the one stable adult. Can the one stable adult be a non-parent or a non-relative and still have a positive effect, assuming the adult is consistent and consistently available? Not necessarily living with the youth, but being available to the youth.
Absolutely. That's what I was saying before, that as a family doctor, I've been faced with, when it comes down to it, a kid who's now in a situation where he hasn't got one stable adult, and you sort of become that stable adult as a doctor. Now, you can do better than that and more extensive than that with social worker, psychotherapist, but basketball coach, you know, say that, like, yes, the other people can step in and give them that self-esteem and that support.
Okay, and I have a question. I spent a little bit of time up in Chisasibi, and you mentioned about going into the bush and the low incidence of dementia, but what I noticed when I was there visiting my wife, who was doing her residency up there, that there was such a high incidence of diabetes and the sedentary lifestyle and eating really poor foods that were flown up from the south. So how do you balance off the potential for great health and then the instances of bad health?
Well, the great health there, I was speaking about mental health, was despite the fact they're in a state of culture shock for the last 300 years that the white man came, and the fact that there's still some elder people who are living the traditional kind of ways, and it's holding them together. What's been devastating in native populations all over the world is that they went from very active physical life to sedentary life, and they adopted our diet, which didn't really work out for them. And for instance, there's the thrifty gene, the idea that these people at times had to store up a certain amount of fatty material, like to get through the winter, almost like polar bears, but it's not gonna help you in Montreal. But there is a native diabetic wave going over the whole world, which has to do with increased sedentary activity or decreased physical activity, their old ways of life, and then probably having two diets, ours and theirs.
Now the question on most people's mind is, are you taking any patients? How does one become a patient of yours or at Herzl?
Okay. Now I'll have to make a public disclaimer that as a chief at Herzl, okay, we have 25,000 patients. We have 60,000 visits a year in Herzl, what I call the Herzl Golf and Country Club, for the people who are patients already. We have 40,000 now in the walk-in. So my responsibility is 48 young doctors training with us, 15 nurse clinicians, 17 part-time doctors, about 10 different programs. So I wouldn't be doing anybody a favor by taking them as a patient. I have my patients. I'm often canceling on them, but I keep up with it, but I can't do it. But we do our best at Herzl to try and take a certain number of new patients. We took in 1,000 over the last year, okay? We still, like I said, it's like the little car at the circus. And the biggest thing you guys could do is talk to your member of parliament about reversing this crazy rule about young doctors not being able to work here until they've gone to the place where there's already enough doctors.
Member of the National Assembly, not Parliament.
Oh, right, just, okay.
Okay, it's my political hat for a moment
okay,
there.
Okay, right.
Next, what modern management techniques have you learned that you have applied yourself to the managing of Herzl?
That's a real fun question, okay? I did, in the management course I took, I learned about lean management, okay? Truth is, they mentioned it in the course, it sort of went by me, but then one of my sons is a chief of an intensive care in a doctor in a hospital in Ontario, Alaska, because of this, he wanted to work here, and OK, okay, you just heard. But at any rate, in his hospital, which was having problems, he told me they brought in some lean consultants. Now, lean is a concept of management that used by Toyota, and it's about a culture of continual improvement where you get information from really all your first line workers and you say, hey, we've got a problem here. You're out there, what do you think? What are we gonna do to fix it? So what I did was I brought some lean consultants from the United States who had worked with Mayo Clinic, Kaiser Permanente, and National Health System in Britain. And they came, and the first 3 days, they sat with all our staff and the first line people, and first day was, how do we work? Second day was, how would we like to work? Third day was, how are we gonna get there? Then they joined us about seven more times over a period of 6 months. And what we did was we got into the habit of when what we saw as a problem, we asked the people who were really dealing with it rather than top-down decisions from the manager, okay? Now I'll give you an example. We asked the doctors, tell us, map out how you spend your time. Well, they were spending 25% of their time looking for stuff, like looking for requisitions, looking for equipment, because we have 38 exam rooms, and everything was all over the place. So we standardized the rooms, that you can walk into any room, and in every room in the same drawer, you find the same thing. Okay. The nurses, they told us they're spending 25% of the time looking for the doctors, okay? Because there was a chart on the wall which said who's supervising the nurses, and everybody was always switching with everybody. Geez, I'm going to the dentist, and Bob, can you know? So the poor nurse was going up in the wards in the hospital looking for the wrong guy. So then the nurses came up with a solution. They said, you know, every 10 seconds there's a computer in Herzl. So if we make a website and everybody has the responsibility of seeing any switches, okay? Now I'm giving you examples. Those are lean techniques. Within 1 year, we increased our capacity to see patients by 25%. I had paid significantly for these consultants, but I got the money back from the government from a surplus fund because we demonstrated that we had done a project that increased our capacity to care for our patients, and we really got it back. So that's an example.
And these lean techniques are now spreading throughout the hospital.
Yeah, that's true, yeah.
To that's create right, more efficiencies and greater capacity to see more patients in every department. So next question is, you mentioned that leading unhealthy habits and leading unhealthy lifestyle choices reduces one's morbidity, mortality, and decreases your age span. But when you have a healthy lifestyle, you have good nutrition and proper exercise, how much can you increase your lifespan?
Well, it's interesting that this figure of half a, you know, some people will feel good that it's walking half an hour a day, you know, it's like considered adequate for this Alzheimer's prevention. And that it's really good to exercise, but there are some studies that beyond like, I'd say half an hour a day or an hour of vigorous exercise, your returns on that level are probably, you know, not gonna be amazingly significant, okay? So you don't have to drive yourself crazy. So I think if you've got something going and a good lifestyle, if it's not broken, don't fix it. But it can't promise you the pie in the sky, but the quality of your life as you're living it is that much more pleasant.
Now, many family doctors talk about the annual physical, going for a checkup every year, and some say it's really not necessary for someone who's healthy and young without any other issues. So what's your opinion on the annual physical?
Yeah, I would agree with the people who say it doesn't have to be religiously annually, okay? Like, I just mentioned that when someone becomes 50, you think about they need a colonoscopy, okay? And I would say, everybody over 50, every so often, every few years, I want to do their thyroid because it may be declining. So for me, if you have a doctor that's been following you in continuity, that if he does these tests over a period of like years, I would say he doesn't have to see you annually. Like, I don't want to put a figure on it, but you're probably going to come to see him anyway about something within 2 years or, you know. So I sort of we all keep a flow sheet of what have we done preventively. And a lot of this kind of fixation about an annual visit was built up by a lot of stress on blood tests that really created a lot of economic kind of glut for, well, it's not so much the doctors, although in some settings the doctors get a percent on the blood tests they do, okay? But it's particularly in the so-called private medicine executive clinics, they run you through a lot of tests that are really doing nothing but increasing their income, and in fact, sometimes create static. They do kind of MRIs and ultrasounds that weren't necessary, that come up with kind of equivocal findings that lead you to more investigation. So I would say I agree that it's something that goes back to the first principle I spoke about, that in a good relationship with your patient, between the both of you, you should be figuring out what you want to do to a degree.
Any last thoughts from you, Dr. Mellis? No more questions, so.
No, except that I've enjoyed talking to you, and I've enjoyed the questions, and thanks for coming.
Thank you very much.